Let's have a look at some architecture patterns for serverless applications, as well as the application integration services that we've covered in this section. So we have a requirement. An application includes EC2 and RDS, and spikes in traffic are causing writes to be dropped by RDS. Well, in this case, you might decouple EC2 and RDS database with an SQS queue, and then use Lambda to process records in the queue. So even where you have an architecture that involves components that are not serverless, like EC2 and RDS, you can obviously decouple those. We've talked about EC2 and decoupling plenty. And it's also a way that you can use a serverless service. So it might be easier to scale the Lambda function. It might be cheaper to run for processing these records than using an EC2 instance to consume the messages from the queue. Migrate a decoupled on-premises web app, and the user's upload files and processing tier then processes and stores in an NFS file system. And this solution should scale dynamically. So for this, you might migrate to EC2 instances. You might use SQS for the queue and EFS for the file system. And you'd use auto scaling and scale the processing tier based on the SQS queue length. So again, we've got some services here that aren't serverless, but again, we're talking about application integration. And one of the things that comes up as a very regular topic in the exam is the ability to scale based on an SQS queue. We covered it earlier in the section. It comes up quite a bit, so make sure you understand that you can do that. And that effectively means the more jobs in the queue, the more EC2 auto-scaling will scale and allow you to process those records. A Lambda function execution time has increased significantly as the number of records in the data to process has increased. A method of optimizing this solution would be to increase the available memory to the Lambda function. So you allocate more memory to your function. That will proportionally increase the amount of CPU, and that might decrease your processing time. So it means you've got more CPU power and more memory available to each function. Of course, another way is to scale by having additional invocations of your function. And you need to understand how to use those two things together. So on the one hand, you might need more memory and CPU for your function, but also if you're doing a lot of records at the same time, then maybe doing them in parallel is a good idea with lots of invocations. Next up, an API gateway forwards streaming data to Lambda to process, and a too many requests exception is experienced. Now we're talking about streaming data here. So straight away when you see that, you need to start thinking about things like Kinesis data streams. So in this case, you might send the data to Kinesis data streams and then configure Lambda to process in batches. So what might be happening here is the API gateway is sending bursting traffic to the Lambda function, and there's not enough concurrency available. It's not able to process all of that data as quickly as it needs to. So putting it on a Kinesis data stream is a form of decoupling, and then processing in batches is going to be more efficient. You're migrating an app with a highly variable load to AWS. It must be decoupled and orders must be processed in the order they're received. Simply use an Amazon SQS FIFO queue. That will preserve the record order and is a great way of decoupling. A company needs to process large volumes of media files with Lambda and it takes over 2 hours. It needs to optimize time and automate the whole process. So we talked before about optimizing, and that might be more memory CPU, but also it might be more invocations, running more in parallel. So how could you do that? Well, you could configure a Lambda function to write jobs to a queue. So then you've got one function taking the data and processing it sequentially, putting it into the queue. Then the queue becomes an input for step functions, which then coordinates a series of Lambda functions to process the data records in parallel. Objects uploaded to an S3 bucket must be processed by Lambda. Simple. Create an event source notification to notify Lambda function to process new objects. A company requires API events that involve the root user account to be captured in a third-party ticketing system. For this, you might create a CloudTrail trail and an EventBridge rule that looks for API events that involve root. We did this in the hands-on lessons where we looked for certain events. You could then put the events into a queue, so the target for the EventBridge rule is a queue, and then process the queue with Lambda. A legacy application uses many batch scripts that process data and pass on to the next script, complex and difficult to maintain. So we've got an application built out of scripts, lots of different things happening, different components, each of which is just a script. So definitely difficult to maintain. You could migrate the scripts to Lambda and use step functions to coordinate the components. So that will give you that orchestrated workflow for this application. Easier to maintain, probably a cost-effective option as well. Lambda processes objects created in a bucket. Large volumes of objects can be uploaded, and you need to ensure that the function doesn't affect other critical functions. So in other words, suddenly there could be bursts of objects coming, and you don't want this Lambda function to be taking away resources that other functions that are critical to your business might use. Well, simply configure reserved concurrency. That sets the maximum limit for the function. It also means that other functions can't use that concurrency as well, so it both reserves it and also sets the maximum. You could then monitor the critical functions CloudWatch alarms for the Throttle's Lambda metric. That's a good metric to see if any of those functions are throttling, which might mean they don't have enough allocation themselves. An EC2 instance processes images using JavaScript code and stores it in S3. Load is highly variable, and you need a more cost-effective solution. Simply replace EC2 with a Lambda function. This kind of thing comes up in exam questions all the time. A Lambda function is often going to be more cost-effective than EC2 because you're only paying when it's actually executed. Also great for highly variable loads because, again, you're not waiting for auto-scaling to scale. More cost-effective, scales really fast as well. A solutions architect needs to update Lambda function code using a canary strategy, and the traffic should be routed based on weights. Now, when we get to the section on code deploy, you'll learn a bit more about the various different options like canary deployments. For now, just focus on weights. So remember, we looked at how we could use weightings to send certain amounts of traffic to different versions. So in other words, you create an alias and you configure the weights to the Lambda versions. We saw how to do this in the slides. An app uses API Gateway Regional REST API, and it's just gone global and performance has suffered. In this case, you might convert the API to an edge optimized API, and that will optimize it for a global user base. Remember that when you have an edge optimized API, it's actually leveraging the CloudFront points of presence, the edge locations. An app uses API Gateway and Lambda. During busy periods, many requests fail multiple times before they eventually succeed. No errors reported in Lambda. This could be that the throttle limit has been configured too low on the API. So rather than the actual Lambda function doing the throttling here, it could be that API Gateway is. Lastly, you need to ensure only authorized IAM users can access a REST API on API Gateway. This can be achieved by setting the authorization to AWS IAM for API Gateway, and that's done at the method level. You can then grant the execute API invoke permissions in an IAM policy, and then you attach that to a group or directly to users. So that's it for this architecture patterns. Hope that was useful to you. See you in the next lesson.